という形で、はい、any questions or comments about last class where I remind you we discussed that as far as we are aware theories made out of single scalar field in four dimensions the only genuine quantum field theory that is a quantum field theory defined as a flow away from a fixed point is the free scalar field theory any questions or comments about any of the things we talked about last year yes
Actually,
in last class, you said that we can differ
positive
scale to the particle scale. Right. To make the particle scale. The free part of the particle. Yeah. So, but my question is that the particle which you are writing is actually UV scale. And when we are fully come to the IR scale. So, if we consider the UV scale free part, that consists of the mass parameter which is not of the UV scale, but of the IR scale. So, if we are...
Okay,
if you are writing the free part of the Lagrange, that consists of the mass parameter, which is the mass parameter not of the UV scale but of the IR.
We've chosen to do that, yes. Yes.
So, if you just see that part, does it mean that our UV theory already knows that what mass parameter our IR theory is going to look at? So, this looks.
Let me say this in another way. It's a very good question. The question you could ask, for instance, is what is the correct criterion for the stability of a quantum field? Okay? Now, if you write down a classical Lagrangian that looks like it has some sort of runaway potential. Here we're not even doing that, it's like a free part. But anyway, suppose you wrote down such a thing. Okay? Right, so our classical Lagrangian, yeah, but that does look like at least it has an instability, right? It has a, maybe it will be picked up again by the final before it later. It looks like it has pretty bad initial instability. Okay, now the question you could ask is that correct? And the answer to that question is that the thing that determines the stability or otherwise of the theory is the shape of the potential of what's called the quantum effective action. Okay, now the quantum effective action is closely related to, in fact, in the theory, the massless particles is equal to the Wilsonian effective action section of scale lambda. As we take lambda, the limit lambda goes to zero. Okay? So the thing that will determine, you know, if you've got some parameter and the issue is precisely the following. It's something that Ronak brought up last time. You see, naively you might think that having a negative mass square is problematic. But that's naive for many reasons. Okay? One of which is that it's problematic only at low enough momenta, so your momenta are smaller than the mass square. Because otherwise, minus m square plus b square still more. Okay? So, the real issue is the volume. You see, what is the effective integral you have to do for the low mass modes? Okay? After having integrated out the high mass stuff, that really determines whether the low mass modes, the low momentum modes are stable or not. And that's what the Wilsonian effective action is. Okay? So you can't just look at the bare action and talk about stability or not. We'll discuss this more. We'll discuss it. We'll prove this theorem that the theory is stable or not depending on the shape of the quantum effective action. So you will see this, we'll prove this. It's very beautifully done in Walt Weinberg's book, chapter 16 or so. Somebody was on the way for discussion class. Okay? But fine. However, so that is the inclusive, the general question. However, you could have asked a more technical question. And that is the reason we had to do the shift class. The technical reason is that in generating our perturbation theory, we had to do some integrals. And it had to be that those integrals that we were doing were going to be fine. Just to make sure that we shifted and unshifted. Just to make our procedure consistent. So it was not an issue of the stability of the theory, it was just to make our procedure self-consistent. Okay. Okay, very good. Other questions about this?
Can we
take
fine-tuning as a renormalization
function? Fine-tuning is not a very precise statement.
Because anyway, we have to tune the...
That's a very good question. Now I understand your question. Yes, exactly. Fine-tuning and the renormalization. If you make a renormalization condition, saying that M is some fixed thing that you keep fixed,
as you have measured.
Exactly, that is the same as the fine tuning. Does everyone understand this? What is the fine tuning? The fine tuning is said in the language of renormalization routine. Suppose we've got a two-dimensional space where we've got one relevant operator, which is the screen. Okay? So all these flows look, so this is the relevant direction, this is the irrelevant direction, flows look like this. And the point is that we're going to flow for an infinite amount of time. We're going to flow for an infinite amount of time. But if you start on a random flow line, you flow for an infinite amount of time, you'll divert off. Out of the ball. How can you avoid that? Well, there is one flow line that if you flow for an infinite amount of time, takes you on the moon. Maybe this one. So how can you flow for an infinite amount of time and yet stay somewhere fine? You have to be on a flow line that approaches this flow line. As lambda naught goes to infinity, you have to approach this flow line in a manner tuned with lambda naught so that after the infinite amount of time, you reach the flow line like this. Okay? This is your renormalization condition. The fact that at scale lambda, you are in square. That's exactly the same as a back line. For a relevant, yeah, for a relevant back line.
So same point, tuning was it explained?
Yes. So the renormalization condition, imposing the renormalization condition, is achieved by a back line. Okay? By going to a flow line that looks very much like the line that will go straight ahead. Okay? This statement is basically the same, or it's very tightly related to the statement that quantum field theories are defined by flows away from fixed points. Because you've got your hitting a flow line that goes to the fixed point, more or less, and then goes. Is this clear? Other questions about it?
Approximate quantum field.
the exact quantum field theories, the thing that we define as the idealized mathematical wonderful things that are autonomously defined, are defined as either, you can say in two ways, either as a limit, or better, as flows away from the from fixed points. But though these idealizations are different, it's the first term in an approximation in A by R. And leading order higher terms will be obtained by putting dimensions of successively higher, operators of successively higher dimension. Is this clear? By the way, this is the people, this is the philosophy people often use when searching for new physics. You know, suppose there's a supersymmetric, you know, suppose there's some supersymmetric particle at 10 TeV, so we haven't seen it. Okay. Now, what is the effect of that? So we are working with the standard one. There's the scale here. Let's say it was at 20. And let's say we've done an experiment at 4. Okay. We're working with a theory which is has just a standard model field. That's only valid down from here. So that's a hard deep flow, but not by very much. Okay? So we should expect new operators to be present, dimension 6 operators to be present, suppressed by 4 by 20 to the power 2. Now this is of course a tricky game, because whether it's 4 by 20 or 4 by 20 by 4 pi squared. Makes a huge difference. Okay? But you get my meaning. That there's some other operator. So the way people parameterize their ignorance often is to say, let me take standard model plus the most general let me write down the most general 5-dimension operator. Dimension 5 field I can write down in the standard. The standard model, as you know, is a renormalizable quantum field theory. By renormalizable, what I mean, it is defined as a flow away from the fixed point. What is the fixed point of the standard model mean? Everyone knows what the standard model is, right? Okay, what is the fixed point? It's the free fixed point. Okay, what is the standard model? What is the standard model? It's a theory of gauge bosons, fermions, and the boson. Okay? The fixed point of the standard model is where the gauge bosons are free, the fermions are free, the scalar is free. Okay? Now, about this free fixed point, we can ask, what are the marginal relevant definitions? Okay? What are the relevant definitions, basically? And the answer, can anyone tell me what the answer in the standard model? What are these definitions? Name. That's the gauge coupling. That's called that.
Yeah. And the fiber.
Excellent. So what? Okay. First, let's look at the complete classically relevant. The classically relevant. There's only one classically relevant. What is that? No. What? What about this? Good.
Yeah, this Higgs.
Higgs what?
The U bubble.
No.
That potential is
the mass. The mass. Two parameters in the potential. Yeah. The mass of the boson. You got d phi squared plus m squared phi squared plus lambda phi. That's what the Higgs potential is. Classically, this is what? Marginal. It's what we've been studying, right? The last few lectures. This is the same theory we've been studying. Okay? Classically, this is relevant. This is this dimension. Dimension 2 operator, fixed point. So in the standard model, there's exactly one relevant operator about the free fixed point. You see, about an interacting fixed point, we can't just write down Lagrangian and know. But about the free fixed point, we can. Okay? So what I'm saying is not a guess, it's exactly one. Okay? Exactly one classically relevant operator. Mass of the Higgs boson. Okay? Because there's exactly one classically relevant operator. There is exactly one hierarchy problem in the standard model. And the one tuning that we have to do very, very sensitively is to get this parameter in the low energy electric action, not go off the planck scale. Okay? That's the hierarchy. So this parameter we have to tune very sensitive. Okay, we're coming to the issue that maybe you worried about. Now let's look at the other parameters. Okay, what are the other parameters? The other parameters, as was mentioned, was this guy. Okay, then there were parameters like the gauge couplings. How many gauge couplings are there in the sample one? Three gauge couplings. Once you specify those couplings, there are no other couplings in the, there are no other parameters in the coupling between fermions, bosons, and gauge couplings. The self couplings of gauge bosons, as well as the couplings of matter, are all determined by three parameters. This is clear. Okay, these three gauge couplings. Now, of these three gauge couplings, we haven't really studied this, we just discussed. So these are classically marginal. Quantum mechanically, are they marginal, relevant, marginally relevant, marginally irrelevant? Does anyone know? What's the gauge group? Standard, oh, sorry, this is ID. just so that you connect, even before we study, just so that you connect what you anyway know to what we study. Okay, so what's the gauge group?
Standard,
SU3 cross SU2 cross SU1. So we've got three couplings because there are three gauge groups. Okay, what is the, is the coupling for the SU3 group marginally relevant or marginally irrelevant?
So you
might say
that
normal
behavior.
Yes,
there
is? Relevant. Good. So that guy is marginally relevant. For the SU2? Marginally relevant. For the U1?
Irrelevant.
Marginally irrelevant. Okay? So, if we were purists and we were doing pure quantum field theory, okay, we would not allow this theory except for a free U1 coupling. But you know, we're not such purists. Because we do know, you see, and this is something very important that I should have emphasized. There is a big difference in practice between logarithmic running and not running. Okay? And the big difference can be illustrated by the following fact. That suppose we've got scale separation like we do have in the real world. It's a huge scale separation. Let's even imagine that there's no physics between us and the Planck scale, T and Planck scale. So the scale separation is sort of like 10 to the 16 or something like that. Okay? Any power law suppression in 10 to the 16 is a huge suppression. So any running that with a classically marginal operator has reached the fixed point, whoosh. On the other hand, what is the log of 10 to the 16? What is log of base 10 of 10 to the 16? It's 16. It's not such a huge suppression. Okay? What is log to base e of 10 to the 16? Well, let's approximate e squared is 10. So not really. Okay? It's 32. You see, so these logarithmic suppressions, even over such huge orders of magnitude, are not very efficient at taking you to the fixed point. Okay? So QED, this flow away in QED from the fixed point, that, you know, in a purest sense, if we really did lambda not to infinity, we would have had no theory except the free U1 theory. But infinity, as far as logs are concerned, is pretty different from 10 to the 16. Okay? And so, that is the practical difference for a free fixed point between a classically relevant and a marginally, so a classically irrelevant and a marginally irrelevant operator. Classically irrelevant operators are damned away. We can forget about them. The marginally irrelevant operators are not in practice. Okay? So, even though there is a conceptual difference between these marginally relevant and marginally irrelevant directions, okay, for practical applications of the sort we have in mind, there's no practical difference. And therefore, for instance, this guy, which we spent the last lecture discussing, is marginally irrelevant. He's still a parameter in the standard model. If the standard model were to be defined in a purest sense, with scale lambda, could only have the three. Are you understanding this? Okay, but because we will treat classic marginally relevant and irrelevant dialects more or less on the same footing, because they haven't had the time to develop it. Potentially, they haven't had the time to develop it. We will count all the operators that are either relevant, classically relevant, marginally relevant, or marginally irrelevant as parameters. Okay, this is an extreme version of that. Of the thing I was talking to you about. That is, you remember, in the purest sense, we will keep only the relevant directions. But then if you want to do better, you keep the leading relevant operators. Now in this case, the leading relevant operators are the marginally relevant operators. And there's a big gap between how much they contribute and the next irrelevant operators. Because these are logs of residence of ours. Big difference. Is this clear? Okay, so the parameters in the standard model are the only classically relevant is the mass square of them. They can speak. So now I'm going to group them all together. The classically marginal operators, whether irrelevant or irrelevant, are 5 to the 4 term, the 3 gauge couplings, and the zillions of Yukawa couplings in the standard model. Okay, Yukawa couplings are also marginally relevant because they're dimensionless. Okay? Right, so the standard model, in a purest sense, would be defined as a flow away from the free fixed point and would have fewer parameters because you wouldn't have the classically irrelevant stuff. But then we look at those RG flows that include those operators also because they're the ones that damp towards. So we look at a larger manifold than the fixed manifold itself, including the classically irrelevant. That's how the standard model is defined. Is this clear? Any questions or comments?
I didn't understand your point about there being only one hierarchy problem because you have to find all the parameters relevant to the marginal rate.
Ah, yeah, you're right. You have to find all of them. But the fine tuning you have to do is by log of 10 to the 16. Which is not considered a hierarchy.
Okay.
It's some number of order work. But the fine tuning you have to do for the Higgs mass is what it 10 to the 16. 10 to the power 16 in some way of saying in square. That's a huge finding. Okay? To what precision do you have to do? You get the point. Okay. Other questions? Comments? Okay, fine. Let us move on.
You pointed out that the fact that RG flows converge is why we can never reduce high energy things from non energy.
Yes.
But considering you're saying marginal, these things are only damped by order 16, you should be able to deduce things from higher energies.
Yes. So you can deduce. Right. So there is some information in these marginal couplings. That's true. But you see, you get full information. Suppose you could figure out all of the numbers behind each of the irrelevant. That could, in principle, allow you to deduce what the energy is. Let's suppose that there is another, let's say we're at some scale, 100 people, and there's another particle with some couplings. Integrating on that particle generates a large set, some values for all the higher dimensional operators in the theory. It's very plausible that if you knew all of this infinite amount of information, you could figure out what the particle was. What its couplings were, without ever having observed it. But here we are left with very little information. Okay, so the these marginally irrelevant operators, as you say, we know something about them. In the same spirit, we also know something in the relevance. Because we know the values of the relevant operators. So all that we do know give us a few equations constraining what's happening in the universe. Those few equations are the number of parameters in the standard. Okay? Now that's more parameters than we want, something in 20 or maybe more with neutrino masses. Okay? But it's much fewer. So, it's more parameters than you want for predictive theory. But it's much fewer than what would be needed to figure out the details of quantum gravity from trying to tackle constraints. Okay? So the information you have on the parameters is static. Okay, other questions or comments? Okay, excellent. So now we're going to continue our study of scalar field theories. Today will be the last lecture, hopefully. I hope so. Before this, actually, there's an organizational issue. What is the attendance going to be in class next week? If we do have class next week, who will still be?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
And who will not be here because of the boarding school? So, 4 of you are not going to be here.
5.
Yeah, 5 of you. So I need some advice on this. What should we do? Should we continue to have class?
So how many classes? 3 classes.
Is that what people would like? The other option is to just go ahead and request these people to watch the video. Would also be a possibility. Are there votes in this? Is it someone?
I have one. First one.
I'm happy to lie. Just, you know, we don't want to get ourselves in a situation where we don't end up saying much of the end of this. Shall we have a compromise solution? Shall I take one lecture instead of 2 next week? Is that okay? We don't like
that.
Will you guys be back by next Monday? No, right? Next week you're gone, I know. The week after that, Monday, nobody's back.
Actually, more than half of that week, after next week is a Monday.
Will you guys be back by week after that, Wednesday?
Yeah.
Yes?
Yes.
Okay, so I'll tell you what. Firstly, the week after that, Monday's class will shift to week after that, Wednesday. Okay? So That's okay? You're not going to be back, you're not looking at me.
Oh, you're talking about the next week of the next week.
Yeah.
Sorry, I'm not.
Are any of you going to be back next?
I'm back on Monday afternoon.
You're back on Monday afternoon. How about you?
I'm not back.
So, the week after that is basically short. Okay, so I think we're going to have to basically continue some sort of schedule, but I'll try to minimize the number of how do we do this? Just give me a minute. See, no clean solution. Have you guys tried watching the video lectures?
Yes.
Do they work? But I mean, do you feel that you get 80% of?
Yeah.
Hmm. So. Okay, so how about that we'll cancel next Monday's class, coming Monday's class. We'll have it on Friday, and we'll have it on the Wednesday subsequent week, and then we'll try to take, let's say, 1 or 2 lectures. That sounds like a compromise in usual way, which reduces one class that you're missing. You'll miss only one, you guys will miss 2. View the video lectures. Is this okay?
Yes.
Are you
going to
have lectures on the holidays?
No. I have children. No, we're not going. Holidays are all. I mean, you guys are free to do what you want. So that's not it. But these are the things. Sorry.
It's fine.
Because otherwise we'll reach November, December, we wouldn't have talked about anomalies, we wouldn't have talked about the things we want. Okay? Excellent. Let's get it. So, uh, By the way, one clearing up from last class. We computed, if you remember, the beta function of the 5 to the 4th theorem. I just wanted to get the number straight. Okay, the number behind that beta function. Because it's one, it's a number that's sometimes used. So, you remember we started 5 to the 4 by 4 factorial. You remember the calculation, I'm just going to work out the number. Okay, we started with 5 to the 4 by 4 factorial and we got two powers of this step. We had a half, and then in the diagram, we had 4 into 3 by 2 times 4 into 3 by 2 times 2. There's a famous identity. Okay. So, 2 into, let's write this as 6 into 4. Into 6 into 4. Into 6 into 6 into 2. Okay? And then this guy multiplied, there was 1 by 2 pi to the power 4 in the integration measure. And then we got the volume of the 3 square, the unit 3 square, which is 2 pi square. Okay, so this is the set of numbers. This comes with a g naught square, or g square. Okay, and then there was some, that's a g naught square, there was some here. Okay, and what are we supposed to compare this with? There's a sign which we got straight last time, right? Just a number. What are we supposed to compare this with? What are we supposed to compare this with? What appears in the action? So we're supposed to compare this with g naught by 4. Okay? So the beta function, the number that comes behind, so if you write dg by d log lambda is equal to some number than g squared. Some number times g squared, that number is the ratio of these two numbers. Right, so that's numbers, this number times this. Okay? So there's an additional 24 that cancels this. Is this clear? What? No, this was 24, this was 24, and this was
24.
This is g naught squared. So we calculated this number. And we're comparing it against g naught by 4 factorial. So we take the 1 by 4 factorial out, common. Okay? So this number, we cancel this 24. So that the number behind the beta function is this. Okay? So now let's see what we can. So 6 cancels 6. 2 cancels 2. Okay, so 4, this becomes 2, cancelling this, that's 3. We get 3 into 2 divided by 16 into 2 by 16. Okay, so that's 3 by 16. This is the number behind the beta function. It's a sort of famous number. Okay, the 3 by 16 pi squared is the number behind the beta function provided for. Not very important, really. I mean, unless you want to actually calculate. But just since it's so easy, I can do it. Sure. Okay. Excellent. So, now, today's lecture is going to be about a non trivial quantum field theory. The so called Wilson-Fisher field theory. Okay? For three dimensional scalar fields. And the idea behind this Wilson-Fisher field. So let me tell you the idea behind it. And then we'll start trying to do a few calculations. The idea behind it goes as follows. We have this G4 operator. And we have dG by d lambda, log lambda. Was equal to 3 by 16 pi squared. The sign is right because it's log lambda goes to 0. Lambda goes to 0, log lambda goes to minus infinity, and g then decays. Okay? Now, they started at order g, g squared, because classically the dimension of the operator was zero. Now, why was the dimension of the operator zero? The dimension of the operator was zero because we were doing 5, 4, and 4 dimensions. How do we judge the dimension of the operator? The dimension of the coupling. Dimension of the operator was 4. Okay. How do we judge the dimension of the operator? Well, we know that in d dimensions, d spacetime dimensions, the dimension of a scalar field is d minus 2 by 2. Okay? If we multiply this by 4, because we have 4 parts, that gives us the net dimension of the 5 to the 4 term. By the way, can somebody tell me why the dimension of a scalar field is about a prefix term? D minus 2 by 2. Kinetic. Exactly. Kinetic of the mass fixes the dimension. Good. So this is equal to 2 into d minus 2. Okay? Now, suppose the dimension had been. So what number comes here? The number that would come here is the dimension of the operator minus 4. So dimension minus d. This is what you would expect in general. Let's see, have I got the sign right? If the dimension is small, we get a negative term, which is right, because this flow to the way I've written this flow to the UV. Okay? So, just classical analysis will give this to you. Well, this is the dimension of the operator. Okay? And now, we want to know what this evaluates to in this case. So, this is simply 2d minus 2 minus d times g, which is equal to d minus 4. Thank you. Okay? So we can write this beta function equation in a fancy way. The beta function equation can be written as dg by d log lambda is equal to d minus 4 times g. Okay? Plus 3 by 60 pi squared g squared. So this is true in D as well. It's made in the average. Okay. So, the virtue of this formula is just simply so that it's some formula which should only be literally taken seriously when you said D equals 4. It's the same formula again. But I've written it in a slightly strange, suggestive way for the following reason. Suppose there is some way of making sense of quantum field theories, or more precisely, because there will be no full wave length, that's what it means. Some calculations of quantum field theories. Renormalization group flow calculations of quantum field theories. In a dimension that is not any integer. Suppose we could devise some way of making sense of that. Okay? And then we continued. Then we could ask, what would the beta function of the theory be in 4 minus epsilon dimensions? Okay. When epsilon is small. We could ask this question. Okay, so what can we say? This term is completely determined by the dimension. So we would get dg by d log lambda is equal to minus epsilon g plus, this would be corrected, but it would be corrected at odd epsilon. Okay. Plus 3 by 16 pi squared into 1 plus some number. 1 plus odd epsilon t squared plus quarter t cube. Okay, just a very general ground, we know this is true. So, suppose we could make sense of this idea of defining quantum field theories in higher dimension, in non-integer dimensions, at least for the point of view of generating renormalization proof laws. Okay? All that this needs to mean, by the way, is some procedure that assigns a renormalization proof flow for an arbitrary dimension that agrees with what we mean, what we know, in every integer dimension. Some analytic continuations of the formulas of quantum field theory past integer dimension. Suppose we can make sense of that. Okay? Then, what would the beta function look like in 4-sensorial dimensions? It would look like this. So, just as a little mathematical exercise. So suppose I'm going to ignore the mass parameter and what follows. Imagine that it's tuned to be zero. Okay, we can do that. At least that event is about small enough. Okay, so let us look at what these renormalization proof flows look like now in 4 minus epsilon. In order to understand that, it's better to write dg by dt. Remember, t was minus 1. If we put epsilon g minus 3 by 2 even pi squared. So 1 plus 4 squared. Now, we'll draw this line in g. So this is g equals 0. Okay? And we're going to draw the flow lines. So one-dimensional flow lines. Okay, what do the flow lines look like near g equals 0? At g equals 0, of course, there's no flow. It's a fixed point. It's at g equals 0, it's 0. But a little away from g equals 0, which direction is the other way? Outwards, exactly. This is the statement that this operator, which was relevant in four dimensions, marginal in four dimensions, classically marginal, has become relevant in 4-sensorial. Because it's classically classically relevant, flow lines point outwards. Okay, but do they always point outwards?
The g squared dominates us.
Yeah, the g squared dominates us. Now let's see where this balances. Where does it balance? It balances when these two are equal. So it balances when g is equal to epsilon divided by 3 pi 16 pi squared into 1 plus of epsilon. Or by Taylor expanded at 1 plus order epsilon is equal to epsilon 16 pi squared by 3 epsilon plus order epsilon squared. Okay, now we've been a little careless because there were also g cubed terms. Okay? But actually this answer is self-consistent. Because at this point, you see, we balanced these two terms. But this was order epsilon square. And this was order epsilon square. This is order epsilon square because g is epsilon and this is explicit epsilon. This is order epsilon square because g is order epsilon. But what would g cube? That would be epsilon cube. So, if we include the correction due to the g cube term, that will give us another order epsilon square correction to g. One order of epsilon further suppressed than one g is. So, this here is actually right, including all directions. So, although in order to know exactly where these two terms balance, we need to know exactly what's going on. When epsilon is small, to order epsilon, we already have enough information. The computer in seconds. Okay? So let's say this point is 16 pi squared epsilon by 3. What do flow lines look after this? Inwards. Where is this diagram reliable? Okay? diagram is reliable at small epsilon, when we can ignore the GQ terms compared to either epsilon G or G squared. Okay? But G cube is negligible compared to both of these in some large range. Until G becomes basically 1. Okay. Let's see. So when does epsilon G stop being? No, it doesn't matter. As long as it's negligible with respect to even one of them, it's okay. Okay? Right. So we can compare G cubed to G squared. And that's negligible as long as G is. Yeah. So this is reliable so long as G is much bigger. Okay? Is this point within the domain of reliability? Yes, if epsilon is small. Because it's this, and that's much more interesting one. Okay, so if there was a way of continuing quantum field theory, at least some aspects of it, to non-integer dimensions, we would have discovered something very, very simple and beautiful. Okay, and that is this: we would have discovered that the flow lines, which in four dimensions or higher than four dimensions, just went this way. Higher than four dimensions, they go that way even classically. Four dimensions, it goes that way because of the beta function we computed. Okay? In four minus epsilon dimensions, becomes the flows become different. This one fixed point splits into two. These two. This guy continues to have the character of these. Attractive. But there is a new, there is a repulsive fixed point as well. Now, the existence of this repulsive fixed point we always knew about. That was a free theory. The fact that the fixed point changes from attractive to repulsive is simply the statement that the dimension of phi to the 4 goes from being higher than d at d greater than 4 to lower than d at d less than 4. This we always knew about. What we have learned from this exercise is that once the dimension of phi to the 4 goes so that it becomes relevant, in small enough dimension near 4, there is a new fixed point. Okay? And this new fixed point, now I'm going to put in the other dimensions. The other dimensions of flow were like this, and will continue to be like this. So they always go just inwards. So, now let me try to schematically draw the renormalization group flow lines for such a diagram. The renormalization group flow lines for such a diagram go like, here, this guy is very simple. Isn't that attractive? This goes in, this goes in, this goes out, this goes out. But this guy is a repulsive fixed point. Okay? But this guy's a repulsive fixed point. Okay? So, this continues to go in, but this way repels. So the flow lines go. How do they go? They go like this, or like that. This is wrong. Let me do it again. Sorry. I'm going to update the dimensions. I'm sorry. Sorry about that. Let's do it again. This guy is attracted to us, but the mass dimension is repulsive. It's relevant. Okay. So every direction goes like this. Okay. Hang on. I'll just finish this. exact brand, the exact shape of the first one. Okay. And yeah. So everything that goes away from here. Okay. So exactly. So this would go like this. This would go like this. This would. So that's how the flow lines would look in this structure.
So
but,
the other half of the
that can be as well defined as flows away from this fixed point. if you tune the starting point here to be. Okay? This is a very interesting situation. In principle, also in practice. We'll talk in 2 minutes about its practical implications. Okay? But look at this in principle. You see, suppose you were somehow, suppose you were a very warped physicist and you discovered this fixed point before you discovered the free fixed point. Okay? You might say, well, and suppose you knew that the scale of ultraviolet physics was very high, Planck scale. You might say, it is not possible to have a theory that goes away from a one-dimensional space. Theories that go away from this one-dimensional space are non-renormalizable, you would have said. Okay? And I don't know how to make sense of them. And then you did experiments and you found that what best fit data is going away from the space, you'd be very puzzled. You wouldn't know how to make sense of these theories. But there is a way of making sense of them as well-defined quantum field theories. But as flows, not only from this fixed point, but from another fixed point. Okay? So this is one possible paradigm for making sense of theories with non-renormalizable. See, non-renormalizable in the sense that there is only one relevant direction away from this new fixed point. Exactly. So, phi to the 4 theory in 4 dimensions. Phi to the 4 theory in 4 dimensions. You know, if you had got your... Then, of course, in that case, there's a log. So that's why we don't care about it so much. But if you had taken lambda not to infinity, you would not have been able to make sense of a theory within directions. That's what we discussed, right? There are no scalar field theories with interactions in a purest sense, in 4 dimensions. Right? So the same situation. Now forget about 4 dimensions, because we're not in. Okay? We're now in 4 minus epsilon dimensions. Okay? We've got this new fixed point. This now has one classically relevant and one classically irrelevant dimension, as we will see. The beta function here is not order g squared, it's order g. Epsilon times order g. Okay? So one classically relevant, one classically irrelevant dimension. About this fixed point, you might say that we have just learnt in our quantum field theory course that quantum field theories that go to the UV are defined as renormalization group flows that come out of fixed points. There's only one direction to come out of our fixed point. That's this one. We've got one parameter set of renormalization group flows. That's the only thing that we can define. If we are here, that will seem impossible. Is this clear? However, this theory is well defined, even when you are out there, all the way to the UV. But its definition is not as a flow away from this fixed point. This definition is as a flow away from this fixed point. So this is one possible paradigm for dealing with non-prenormalizable interactions. It's possible that when you look at a theory and you see that there are non-prenormalizable interactions, the theory is actually well-defined all the way to the UV. And the way it's well-defined is that in your space of quantum field theories, there is another fixed point, which you didn't know about. And your theory is defined as a flow away from that fixed point. This is an example of how it works. Is this clear? Through over the years, many people have suggested that this is a possibility of quantum gravity. It goes by the name of the possibility of asymptotic safety. So when you read papers in the archive that talk about the asymptotic safety paradigm for gravity, it's the claim that in the space of integrals over the metric, there is a new fixed point. Quantum field theory is defined by that fixed point. There are flows away from that fixed point that take us to near to the free fixed point, and that is how quantum gravity makes sense. It's a minority point of view. It doesn't seem very likely to be true, in my opinion. But this is the idea. Yeah?
But is there a thing? So, whether your cross section converge or not should not be difficult.
Like whether your cross section, which cross section?
Like any cross section, whatever. Whether your integrals converge should not matter, depend on how you define it, right? Finally, you are just going to do an integral and add boundary terms and say that okay, after this point I won't be able to add, I won't need to add boundary terms. So like, how does it matter that you, if you not have to worry about RG if flows everything?
Right. Right. How does it matter? You see, the point is what you are doing is perturbation theory around here. Okay? So what you will be, so the idea would be that there is a set of integrals that will converge. Okay? But you're not, the technique you're using is wrong. Because you're going to do perturbation theory. So we should switch. In this particular example, this is free and this is it. In the application of quantum gravity that I'm suggesting, it would be reversed. This is the free point, this is the interacting point. That would be the idea. Okay? But the idea would be that if you could define this path integral and do the integral, the point is you can't, because it's an interacting thing. You would not find divergences. What you'd get, if there are these divergences when you do the answer, around here. Okay? Except for the fact that this is reversed.
Yeah.
Yeah. Something very similar would be. Okay?
Yeah.
Once again, what you're doing is trying to define quantum gravity is the claim. Okay, I want to emphasize this out very unlikely to be true to me for various points from various points of view. But you know, one should never say never. Weinberg, for instance, keeps writing review articles saying he thinks there's now good evidence for asymptotic safety. Sounds like total nonsense to me. but anyway, and you know, who knows? Till we got the right answer, we don't know. So in that case, what you're trying to do is somehow define gravity as an inversely normalization flow, group flow, from this fixed point. And that definition is problematic. Leads to all these divergences. Because you flow away the many directions in which you flow. That's the heart of the divergences. You understand this? Okay? But the point is that if you broaden your point of view, there's one distinguished point from which to start. That's this fixed point. So if you knew about this fixed point, you would be fine. That is the idea.
I'm a bit confused. Are you saying there is a 4 minus epsilon dimensional theory along with the 4 dimensional theory? Because if we just have the 4 minus epsilon dimensional theory, are we having the initial fixed point from where all operators are like relevant?
This one?
Yes. Because in 4 minus epsilon, there will be some. Like 5-4 will be an element.
No, 4 minus epsilon, 5-4 is relevant. That was the calculation we did. You see, in 4 minus, the dimension of 5 to the 4 is less than 4 and 5-4. Let's take the example of 3. The scaling dimension of 5 is half in 3 dimensions. And therefore, dimension of 5 to the 4 is 2 in 3 dimensions. Okay? So the free fixed point is relevant. Dimensional analysis says 5 to the 4 is relevant. But there is a new fixed point. Because it's non-perturbative. It is not, sorry, not non-perturbative, but non-free. About which this 5 to the 4 term is irrelevant. Okay. Now, this calculation of extending quantum field theory to non-integer dimension can be seriously done. And we will do this. Okay? But before I even take it, undertaking this exercise, let me tell you why we're going to undertake this exercise. Why are we undertaking this exercise? We're undertaking this exercise because we're interested in a particular dimension less than 4, namely 3. Okay? Now, of course, you're immediately going to say, well, epsilon is not small, but epsilon is 1. That's true. But this is often what theorists do. You know, you find a problem which you cannot solve. You enlarge it to a one parameter set of problems, which you can solve at one end, and then systematically correct, trying to approach the problem you can solve. In perturbation theory. This is a standard tool of the theorist. Okay? Now, what you do is to take a problem you cannot solve and reduce it to an infinite number of problems that you can solve. Namely, each order and perturbation. Okay? By doing this, you can try to learn about what happens here. Sometimes you succeed, sometimes you don't. It's okay. But already this is giving you insight. Because in 4 minus epsilon dimensions, this bitwise certainly does exist. So as you change epsilon slowly from some small to a number to 1, it's plausible that it continues to exist. In fact, it's more than plausible. People have accurately computed a lot of the properties of this thing at d equals 3 by going to sufficiently high order in this so-called epsilon expansion. As we will discuss. What? Why does it start at 3?
Why not start at
3 equals 3? Because then you have no reliable calculations to do.
You see, you don't know
this fixed point is not a free fixed point. So we cannot do ordinary perturbation theory. We can if d equals epsilon. Because although it's not free, its coupling constant is epsilon. So what justifies perturbation theory? Epsilon. But at d equals 1, that's not reliable. Now that's the kind of thing a lot of people do, you know. Mean field theory, uncontrolled approximations. Uncontrolled approximations that are never controlled. Those are very dangerous things. Here you've got some approximations given that's well controlled, at least when epsilon is small. You study it in detail and then try to see what happens as epsilon is small. That's the idea. Go on.
The thing is, I don't mind that epsilon is 1. I just mind that the factor in front of the 16 pi squared by 3 which is vastly greater than 1. I mean, if you consider that to be an expansion parameter, then and g is, of course, an expansion parameter.
Now what to say? You know,
I mean, you can't even use the argument that you gave for the beta function
good.
Over there.
But you see, you have to be a bit careful. Because you found that g is 16 pi squared epsilon by 3. But you need to know what is the right factor that weights perturbation theory. Of course, perturbation theory is weighted by g. But there could well be various factors of 4 pi squared in the denominator. Okay? In fact, there are. Typically, there are. This comes from, as you know, the measure factors. Okay? So the question is whether the true effective parameter of perturbation theory is less than, is, you know, vast.
So what is the parameter we're expanding for? Are we expanding about g, or are we expanding in g, or are we expanding in g times the measure factor? I mean, how are we guaranteeing
what is the guarantee that
it's a perturbation theory? I mean,
what is the relevant question? The relevant question is to compute this,
yes,
and then compute the next order.
And see that
the next order is smaller than the first.
Are we still guaranteed to get a convergent the series, or will we be satisfied with being an asymptotic series?
Perturbation theory is almost never convergent.
It's always asymptotic.
Almost always.
Almost always.
Yeah. You know, if you try to compute, well, you might. I taught a class where I. You were not. I taught a class in which I discussed computing the. In quantum mechanics, you've got a harmonic oscillator. You add a g x to the 4 term. You compute the change in the energy levels as a function in g. What is the nature of that series?
This is well known in QED, for example.
Yeah, but I'm saying it's much simpler than QED. It was you think QED is simpler than harmonic oscillator. I'm saying that almost any problem in quantum mechanical perturbation theory, open shift, pick out a problem that he works out in quantum mechanical perturbation. Ask for the nature of that perturbative series. Quantum mechanics, one harmonic oscillator, 5 to the 4, it's not convergent. Perturbation theory very rarely converges. We don't care about that. Okay? That doesn't affect very much. Okay. Yeah. Good. Other questions, comments? What? Irrelevant directions are all just zoomed to the number.
In this case also.
Oh, this case also. Okay. So now, let's discuss first why we are interested in this particle form theory. Okay? Why are we interested in this scalar theory? Well, of course, you know, it sounds interesting, but there's a very practical reason for being interested. And I want to discuss that So we have a slight divergent, a slight digression to understand the theory of critical phenomena. Okay. Consider a spin system in three dimensions. Okay. A system of spins in three dimensions, three spatial dimensions. Okay. So it's a block of objects that have some spins. And let's suppose that the spins have the property that your Lagrangian has a up to down symmetry. So the kind of action, the typical model for this is the so-called Eisenmodel. Okay? Where spins are either up or down, they interact with an S1 dot S2. Okay? And spins either up or down, they interact with an S1 dot S2. And there's a clear symmetry in the problem between flipping all spins from up to down. Okay? Consider any such model, at finite temperature. As we have discussed, a quantum system, as we have discussed a quantum system that's three-dimensional, at finite temperature is described by some sort of path integral on R3 times S1. Okay. Now, if we're interested in long distance physics, long distance on the scale of the inverse temperature of this S1, effectively this is some three-dimensional path integral. Because we just Kaluza Klein on these things. So it's an infinite number of massive particles for a three-dimensional. If we're interested in long-distance physics on the scales much larger than the inverse temperature, then we integrate out those massive particles. Okay? Now, you could ask, it sometimes happens as you change the temperature, as you well know, that there is a phase transition. Now, there are two kinds of phase transitions in nature. There are discontinuous phase transitions, sometimes called first order phase transitions, or the continuous phase transitions. And it's a feature of second order phase transitions that in the neighborhood of the phase transition point, physics becomes scale invariant. The correlation functions diverge. Correlation lengths diverge. Physics develops a scale invariant. The schematic reason for this is you can see from a Landau-Ginzburg kind of diagram. A second order phase transition happens when, as you tune the parameter, like the temperature, the effective potential for some scalar field goes from being this to flat to this. When it becomes flat, you get a massless value. So, integrating out all our massive stuff. Got effectively scale in physics. This is a cartoon idea. But that's it. Okay? So this is a cartoon idea of what happens when you have a second order phase transition. Okay. Now, in the neighborhood of such a phase transition, and magnetic particles often have such a phase transition. Magnetic systems, like this spin system we were talking about, often have such a phase transition. You know all about it. You know that this is the case. Magnetic systems often have such a phase transition. And this is the phase transition of spontaneous magnetization. Higher temperature, there's no magnetism. Low temperature, there's spontaneous magnetism developed. You go into this phase. And at the critical temperature, you've got some massless physics at some point. Okay?
Are we scaling waves related to the correlation with?
You see, if you have a correlation length that's finite, it's not scale invariant because it's length. Okay? Correlation length goes up, there's no distinguished length. Okay. Now, this happens in quantum magnetic systems in three dimensions when you heat it up. or in just in model classical kind of systems in three dimensions, where you write down this Isaac model, SI.SJ, and you tune some parameter. Okay, this happens as a function of that parameter in three dimensions. The question is to try to understand, okay, and this kind of, you know, in real systems, this happens in magnetic systems. Very similar things happen in liquid-solid transitions. There's the so-called triple point in the phase diagram of water. It's also described by phase scalenary theory. Now the physics of the scalenary point is very interesting. Okay, the physics of the scalenary point is very interesting, and many interesting things happen in the neighborhood of the scalenary point. Okay, so we'll describe this all in the language of magnetism. And I want to show you, and the goal of the rest of this lecture, to show you, the goal of the rest of this lecture is to show you how very little information of the fixed point that governs this theory relates, computes many of these theory. So suppose we've got some magnetic system that has a critical temperature T. Okay? Then T minus TC, let's define that as T. Okay? When let's ask, for instance, well, what happens to the correlation? So suppose you get two spins in the system, you compute the correlation. Away from T equals TC, because there's a mass gap, they die off exponentially. Okay, so there's some e to the power zeta x. Okay? This correlation length goes to zero as T goes to TC. Infinity as T goes to TC because it's becoming scalenary. Question, how does it go to TC? As T approaches TC, you know, what's happening? How does it go to infinity? By this picture of renormalization group flows in quantum field theory, as I now want to explain to you. Okay? You see, the main point here, how does this connect to the how does this connect to the kind of analysis we've been doing? As we said, the spin system, whatever it is described by some path integral in three dimensions plus a circle. We now look at distance scales because we're interested in systems where the correlation length is diverging. We look at distance scales much, much larger than a circle. And imagine a path integral that involves only the zero modes of the circle after having integrated out all the other higher modes. Okay? We don't know anything about this path integral. We know the initial Lagrange is very complicated. We don't know much about it. But we do know that it's described by a path integral involving spins. And let's say that there is some sense in which you can model the spin by some scalar field. The fact that there was S to the minus S symmetry tells you that there will be phi to the minus phi symmetry in this action. So why we know nothing else about the theory, we believe that it's governed by some path integral of a scalar field with phi goes to minus phi symmetry in three dimensions. This is a Euclidean path integral. Okay, that's all we know about the problem. Okay, professing complete ignorance, but we know one other phenomenological fact. We know the fact that this path integral that we do will of course be a function of temperature. And as temperature changes, meaning as we vary along a one parameter set of initial path integrals, at one point we reach the space transition. Now, let's put this in the language of the renormalization group flows we've been saying. The scale of the inverse temperature is like lambda naught. Because at highest, you know, what we've got is a path integral, which is on R3 times S1. If we went to lambda naughts larger than the inverse temperature circle size, larger than the temperature, you know, this thing, okay, then we would not be justified in doing a three-dimensional path integral. Before that. Okay, so at some scale that is set by the circle size, the size of the inverse temperature. Okay, that's where our path integral, our renormalization group flow analysis starts. Okay, so there's some lambda. The scale we're interested in is the scale of the correlation function, zeta. Everything that we will do will only work when zeta times this S1, you know, when this is a much longer length than this. So that we've got scale separation, so that we can use the ideas of the renormalization. But luckily, the problem of zeta going to infinity is precisely that range. Okay? So, what are we doing? We're starting in the UV with a one parameter set of initial conditions. So, we're looking at a one parameter set of flow lines. And what we're finding is that as we vary along this one parameter set of flow lines, there is one point on this one parameter set of flow lines, namely one point on the space of initial temperatures, at which we find scale invariance. Zeta diverges, we get scale invariance. What does that sound like? That sounds like at that one point we're flowing to a fixed point. Because only fixed points, as far as we know, have scale invariance. Scale invariances are the beta functions vanish. You change till lambda, nothing changes. But that's a fixed point. So, in the space of UV varies, we take some one-dimensional line that is chosen out by the physics of these twin systems. That we take some one-dimensional line, and somewhere on this one-dimensional line, we hit the fixed point when we flow to infinite amount of distance. What does that mean? What does that tell us about the fixed point? What? It tells us that the give me 2 minutes if that's okay.
Oh god, I'm sorry. Oh, great analysis.
it tells us that the attractive manifold of the fixed point is co-dimension 1. Because on the space of all theories, everything is infinite, but the co-dimension is 1, so that if you draw one line, it will somewhere hit this attractive manifold. Is this clear? What does that mean in terms of relevant operators? It tells us that there's a fixed point with one relevant operator. Okay? I'm sorry, I'm going to have to stop here. Where is I going to say this? They have a talk. Yeah, okay. I'm sorry, I'm going to have to stop here. Very unsatisfying. The punchline is nice. Next class is now next Friday. Doug's class. On Monday. Okay, I'll tell you when. Okay, we'll have it. Okay. Thank you. Yes, sorry.